Good morning and a very warm welcome to St Denis Lisvain. I'm delighted to be with you again this morning. And kids, it's fantastic to have you with us too. I'm so delighted that you're able to join us week by week as well. And I hope that you've all been enjoying the Bible series as we've been going through it over the past few weeks, looking at how God alone can answer those deep longings of the human heart, the longing for meaning and purpose, the longing for freedom, the longing for love. And today we're going to be looking at the human longing for community. I don't know about you, but over the past few months, I've come to realise just how much I need community. I need other people. And I say that as an introvert. I'm sure you're exactly the same. We all need community, don't we? And what we're going to see this morning is that God, through His Spirit, answers that cry for community, for relationship, as nothing else in this world can. But as we begin our service, let's begin by praying together. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are an eternal community of love. We thank you that you have made us in your image to enjoy community and relationship too. And we pray that as we turn to your word this morning, as we think about what it has to say to us about community and relationship, that we would see how this deep longing that we all experience is ultimately satisfied in you alone. And we pray that we wouldn't simply see it, but that we would come to know the relationship that you offer us with yourself and with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, let's sing our first song together, All Creatures of Our God and King. A few weeks ago, we heard a fantastic spoken word piece written and performed by Di Woolridge. Well, today we're going to hear another spoken word piece focusing on the theme that we're looking at today. But this time, although written by Di, it's performed by Jermaine Wong.
This is the six-beat, six-piece scripture story. This is the overarching rescue plan story. This is part five of the better story. Love. Love resurrected on Sunday, but what about Monday? For 40 days, Jesus showed up in so many ways, unpacked the scriptures with believers on the road to Emmaus. Their hearts burned with passion. Risen Jesus amazed us, made Thomas believe with nail marks in his side. The barbecued fish must have tasted sublime, said, wait for the Spirit, then ascended on high. So they waited. On lockdown, they prayed and anticipated the arrival of the promised Holy Spirit in the room. They waited, and guess what? The Spirit filled it, a rushing wind, tongues of fire, a community consumed with a burning desire to lift God higher in dialects they hadn't heard of just 5 minutes prior. And Jews get confused, but they're not in the know. They just thought the team knocked back too much of that Merlot. But Pete puts them straight. We're not drunk, mate. Believe us, it's the Spirit of Jesus that's living within us. Joel said, oh, we'll dream dreams and the young men will have visions. And the church goes on mission, but they were persecuted. Just take the stoning of Stephen, where their number one target Saul looks on with approval and hurls the stone throwers' jackets and the church just scatters. Missionary becomes martyrs. But then a game-changing moment on the road to Damascus. Saul swaps sides, and it's cause he's met Jesus. From persecutor to proclaimer, the gospel for the Jews and Gentiles is Paul's disclaimer. Good news spreads from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, Middle East to Europe, bustling town areas. Paul pens the gospel in a series of Spirit-filled letters. On his journey, Paul plants churches, but the Spirit grows communities. But it's not down to this rabbi tent maker. It's the Holy Spirit. He's the enabler. He's the faith filler. He's the courage giver. Just look at Peter. How do you think he changed from chief denier to leader? And the good news has kept on spreading 2,000 years later. We're sealed with the same Spirit that raised up our Savior. Connected and eclectic, it's radical diversity for all ages and accents and every ethnicity. There's unity in the Spirit. He's bringing back community. Church, this is our community, adopted into his family with a reach that's global but still connected locally. This is our part in God's unfolding story, to be missionaries on a movement that tells of his glory.
Last week we were looking at Jesus, and we finished up by thinking about his death and his resurrection. But what happened next? Well, our next video is going to open up the Bible and take up the story for us.
You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. The Jewish authorities commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Which is right in God's eyes? To listen to you or to God? You be the judges. As for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard." After further threats, they let them go. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. As Saul neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Paul took the disciples and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years. So that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile.
Well, welcome once again to part 6 of our series, the Bible series, Experience a Better Story. Today, our theme is spirit and community. If we've learned one thing from lockdown, it's surely this, that we need community far more than we ever thought we did. Technology like this is fantastic. Zoom is great, but it is no substitute for the real thing, is it? It's no substitute for real face-to-face community. Ironically, even though we live in an age in which the world is more connected than it ever has been, recent years have witnessed what's been called a loneliness epidemic, and that's true especially among the young social media users who are, in theory, more connected than anyone else. But that there is this deep thirst for community shouldn't come as a surprise to us if we've read through the Bible story. Because what we discover is that the God who made us is himself community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three persons living in this community of love for all eternity. Relationships and community are central to who God is. And we are made in his image. And so we shouldn't be surprised that relationships and community are also intrinsic to who we are. In fact, when God makes the world, he says it's very good. But there's one thing that isn't good. He says it's not good that Adam should be alone. And so he creates Eve, and together Adam and Eve form the first human community, and together they are able to flourish. We are created by a relational God. We are created for community, and it's when we find ourselves rooted in community that we are able to really flourish. And the opposite is also true. Loneliness is harmful. In fact, Chicago University's Center for Cognitive and Social Neuroscience researched this a few years ago. And what they found was that loneliness causes disturbance in sleep, it impairs our immune system, and it actually increases the odds of an early death by about 20%. In fact, it's as important a risk factor for early death as obesity and smoking. So what is the answer to this loneliness? What is the answer to this longing for community that we all experience? Well, in the Bible, we see that the Spirit is the key to true community. And this morning, I want to show you just three things from the Bible about the Spirit and community. First, the Spirit brings us into relationship with the God who is community. Last week we saw how Jesus is the long-promised Messiah, the snake crusher, the King of the world, how he came to establish his loving reign under which we would all flourish, how he would put all things right and restore Eden. When he was crucified, his disciples were nearly shattered. They had spent the last 3 years with Jesus. They'd staked everything on him. And it all seemed to be coming to nothing that night when Jesus was arrested and taken to be crucified. But as we saw last week, that was actually all part of the plan. 3 days later, Jesus rose again. And you can imagine the disciples' joy as Jesus comes back to him. Surely now would be the time that this king was going to throw off the Roman oppressors and establish his reign across the whole of the world. But instead, he says to them that now he's going to leave them. Now he's going to go back to their father. Imagine their shock and their horror when he says that to them. But Jesus also assures them that he will not be leaving them on their own. He will ask the Father to send another helper. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. What Jesus is saying is this, that when he ascends to be with his Father, he will ask his Father, and his Father will pour out the Holy Spirit on the church. And through the Spirit, Jesus himself will come and be with his church as never before. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. We mustn't think of the Holy Spirit as coming a little bit like a substitute teacher, just filling in the gap until the real teacher returns. No, Jesus says it's going to be better for you that I should go away. You see, through the Spirit, the disciples are going to come into a much more intimate relationship with Jesus than they have ever had before. And that is an astonishing thing to say. Remember that these guys have been with Jesus over 3 years. They've eaten and drunk with him. They've walked and talked with him. And yet their relationship with him is going to get richer when the Spirit comes. See, when the Spirit comes, he will dwell within them. And through the Spirit, they are going to be united with Jesus so that Jesus makes their hearts his home. As Jesus goes on to say in verses 20 and 23, in that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. And here's the great news. That promise is not just for them, it's for you and for me. Through the gift of the Spirit, we too can be brought into a real living relationship with Jesus. And this isn't an ethereal or abstract relationship. This is a real, tangible relationship with God. It is felt. It is experienced. This is how Paul puts it in his letter to the church in Rome. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So when will all this happen? On the day of Pentecost. On that day, the Spirit was given and the church was never the same again. To give you just one example, do you remember how Peter, just a few weeks before, had been so timid that when he was challenged by a slave girl, he caved in and said he didn't know Jesus. And yet now, moments after being filled with the Spirit, he goes out, stands up in front of the crowd, in front of the very people who put Jesus to death, and he tells them that the crucified carpenter is in fact the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who has ascended and is reigning on high, and they should repent and seek his forgiveness. What a transformation. And it happens because the Spirit has been poured out into his heart. Through the Spirit, we are brought into a new relationship with God that is life-changing and transforming. Raj is someone who has experienced the reality of that life-transforming experience for herself.
I was brought up as one of seven children, and as I was growing up, I could feel my parents would treat me differently. For example, my dad would be playing with my brothers, hugging them, and I'd go in for a hug, and he'd just push me aside. My brothers and sisters could see how dad was different towards me, and they also would call me names and hit me and mock me. So I had this sense always as a kid that there was something wrong with me, and I wasn't wanted. And also never felt loved by them. I tried to do what I could to be good enough for them, but nothing I seemed to do was good enough. When I used to come home from school, I was forced to do all the housework. And I remember one evening while I was cleaning and everyone was asleep, my mum's tablets were there, and I started to take all these tablets, wishing I was dead. And the next morning, my dad turned around and said to me, "Shame, it didn't work." And I think the reality hit me that there's nothing I can do to make this man love me. So when I was 18, I finally ran away from home, and I just rebelled against the culture I was brought up. I started drinking, smoking, partying, and I also rejected God. I actually blamed God. But fundamentally, the thing I wanted more than anything was to be loved and find love. I moved to London with a boyfriend, and I found myself getting involved in some really dodgy stuff. But also at this time was a time when I met my first ever Christian. And this lady just showed me unconditional love. She was kind, she listened to me and made me feel of worth. One evening, I found myself crying. I found all the stuff that I had pushed down through my whole life, all the pain just coming up to the surface. And I heard a voice say, "Raj, stop crying." and I knew it was Jesus. I don't know how, but I knew it was Jesus. And I found myself talking to Jesus for the very first time, asking him why. Why was my life so hard? And I just said to him, I just don't want to do it anymore. Would you just take my life? I just want to be dead. And what I felt was, rather than me being beamed up to heaven, I felt just love being poured into me. And I felt the Holy Spirit come and fill all that God emptied out, just fill me up. And I felt this peace and joy and just happiness for the first time. So I started to go to church, and I was surrounded by a community of people that loved me, accepted me, and I, for the very first time, I felt like I belonged to a family. And in the process of my time there, they prayed for me. I dealt with a lot of the pain and the rejection. I found my voice and my purpose in life. And my life is completely transformed by Jesus. And I'm just so thankful to God for all that he's done for me.
That is such a wonderful story of the reality of being brought into relationship with God and the transformation that follows. And one aspect of that transformation was the way in which, after Raj had met with God, she found that she was part of this new community. She says that for the first time in her life, she felt that she belonged to a family. And that takes us to our second point. The Spirit brings us into relationship with each other. Back in Genesis, when Adam and Eve sinned, the vertical relationship with God was broken. And as a result, their horizontal relationships with each other immediately started to break down too. They started to blame each other for their sin. And in the subsequent generation, one of their sons killed the other one. And so it goes on as you read through Genesis. When the vertical relationship with God is broken, so our horizontal relationships start to fall apart. But as we saw in Raj's life, when that vertical relationship is restored, so our horizontal relationships are transformed. When we receive the Spirit, we become members of God's church. We're brought into his family. The book of Acts follows on from the Gospels, and it tells the story of the early decades in the life of the church. And in Acts 2, just after the day of Pentecost, we have this description, a glimpse of what life was really like in that church from day to day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Notice this, that the church is not primarily an institution. There were no bishops, no vicars, no Gothic architecture. No, the church is fundamentally a community. It's a community of people filled with the Spirit, sharing their lives together. Now, it doesn't mean that this community is perfect. As we read on, we discover that there were different problems that they had to address. Church life, like all life, is messy. And yet there is something beautiful about this community. There is something we see here that we cannot find anywhere else, because this is God's new creation by the Spirit. Let me highlight just four things for you. First, this community loved being together. As the passage says, they were devoted. Being part of this community wasn't a duty, it was a joy. They delighted to be meeting up together. And they didn't just meet up for an hour on a Sunday, have a cup of coffee, go home, see you next week. No, they loved being together. And so they went from house to house, spending time in each other's company. You couldn't keep them apart. And second, this community was full of joy. They broke bread in their homes. They ate together with glad and sincere hearts. I've been to many church services where I wondered if I'd accidentally stumbled into a funeral. But you couldn't have made that mistake with this church. If you had gone past one of their meetings, you would have heard laughter and joy. These are people who know they are not worthy, but God has poured his Spirit into their hearts and they know that they are loved and accepted by him. Third, this is a community that is sincere. Now, sincerity is the opposite of hypocrisy. And our English word hypocrisy comes from a Greek word that was used of an actor who, when putting on a performance, would put up a mask to his face. There's no hypocrisy here. This is a church marked by sincerity. There's no pretense, there's no performance, there's no showboating or posturing. Through the gift of the Spirit, this church knows that they're all loved and accepted by God, and so they are free to take the mask off, to be who they really are. This is a community in which there can be open, honest, authentic relationships. And then finally, this is a community that is diverse. Do you remember The Lord of the Rings? Frodo the Hobbit is given a task. He's told to take the ring to the cracks of doom so that it can be destroyed. But he cannot do it alone. And so he forms the Fellowship of the Ring. It is a motley crew made up of a dwarf and elves and humans and hobbits. And actually, the church is quite like that. It's also a fellowship and it's also incredibly diverse. First, it's racially diverse. Now, the church began as a sect in Jerusalem, but it soon began to reach out. As we read through Acts, we see how it becomes a global movement, how it embraces Samaritans, Africans, Europeans. You know, we tend to think of the church as a Western European institution, don't we? But actually, in those early centuries of the church's life, many of its key leaders came from North Africa. And even today, the centre of the church isn't Canterbury or Rome. It's probably Africa or Latin America or China. Now, the church was and is a racially diverse community. But the church is also a socially diverse community. Now, Roman society was sharply divided into different classes. You had patricians, equestrians, plebeians and slaves. And it was strongly patriarchal, so that women were denied the same rights and privileges that men got to enjoy. But in the community of the church, all of those barriers just melt away because the church is one in Jesus. This is what Paul says. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. As they gathered together, the church broke every social convention as men and women, slaves and free, sat down together, enjoyed a meal, and then worshiped their God as brothers and sisters in Christ. And then finally, we see the diversity of the church in the extraordinary mix of personalities. We have Paul, this towering intellect. We've got Peter, the bold leader, but he doesn't always understand Paul's letters. And then we've got Barnabas with his great heart of encouragement. And of course, there are countless other people of every possible stripe who make up the church. Now, the church has room for every personality. Now, only the gospel can create a community like this. No matter who you are, no matter what your background is, there is room for you in God's family. Well, our final point is this. The Spirit enables us to become part of God's great story. The church isn't only like the Fellowship of the Ring in that there is this enormous diversity. It's also like that fellowship in that it too has a mission and a purpose. The church is called to be involved in God's story, his great plan for the ages. You know, if our lives are reduced to being about no more than the next football match, what films are on Netflix, what fashions our friends are wearing, we're soon going to find ourselves feeling depressed and empty because we weren't created to be simply satisfying our superficial appetites as passive consumers. No, we were created for something far greater than that. We were created to be part of God's great story. We were created to be part of his eternal plan for the ages. And it's in that that we find our true meaning and purpose. The book of Acts begins with this striking phrase. Luke writes, "In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach." That former book is, of course, Luke's gospel. But do you see what he's saying here? He's saying that in that gospel, he recorded what Jesus began to do and to teach, what he did while he was on earth. But Jesus hasn't stopped. He has continued to do and to teach through his church. And if we are his church, then we are called to be part of his great mission in the world. And then at the very end of the book of Acts, we find another very telling sentence. By this time, Paul is in prison, and it looks as if the whole of this church movement might be coming to an end. The great leader is locked up, looking at the possibility of execution. Until we get to the very last line. Paul proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. Paul may be in prison, but the gospel isn't. The gospel is unbound, without hindrance. It's no accident that Luke should make that the very last word of his book. What he's saying to us is this: Paul may be in prison, but that will never be the end of the story. This story is to be continued, and it's to be continued through you and through me. You see, this is our moment. Now is our turn. We suddenly find that we are part of this story that we've been looking at over the past few weeks. And the question is, how are we going to respond? Well, can I urge you not to waste your life? God is inviting you to participate in his great story, the greatest story of the ages. And the question is, will you? We have a choice. You know, we could waste our lives by spending them in what is trivial and temporal, or we can make our lives really count by investing in what is weighty and eternal. I can't put it any better than Jim Elliot. Jim Elliot was a missionary from the 1950s who died laying down his life in the cause of God's mission. And he said this: "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." But how are we to do it? If you're anything like me, you'll feel a very keen sense of your own inadequacy and weakness. You'll know that you're not up to the task. You just haven't got the strength to see it through. And we don't have the resources in ourselves. But God gives us two things that make it possible. First, he gives us his Spirit. And when he pours his Spirit out into our hearts, so he equips us with everything that we're going to need to fulfill the mission that he's calling us to. And then secondly, he gives us each other. You know, just like Frodo couldn't have done it without the other members of the Fellowship of the Ring, so we can't do it without each other. The mission that God is calling us on is all about community. I need you and you need me. We cannot go it alone. And when we're struggling, then we need to say to each other, "Look, I need help. I need prayer." It's not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of wisdom. And if we're doing really well, then we need to be proactive in looking out for other people, noticing where others are struggling and offering them help, drawing alongside, giving them support and encouragement. You know, we've had that fantastic news this week, haven't we, that the vaccine is coming. There is light at the end of the tunnel, but there are going to be some very difficult days ahead. And I know that members of our church here in Lisvane are struggling. So let's be looking out for each other. Let's be proactive in supporting one another, because we are in this together. Well, as we come in to land, what have we seen this morning? We've seen that in all of us, there is this deep thirst for community, for relationship. And we've seen that it can ultimately be satisfied by God alone through his Spirit, because it's his Spirit that brings us into relationship with him. It's his Spirit that brings us into relationship with each other. And it's his Spirit that equips us to be part of his great mission in the world. All of this may be new to you. You may not be a Christian. And yet, as you've been listening to this, you sense this is true. I believe this deep down. Well, if that's you, I'm going to pray in a moment, and I would ask you just to join in the prayer with me. Or you may be a Christian and this all seems a bit alien, that God just seems actually distant in your life. You feel a bit like a dry stick and you need the Spirit to come and fill you afresh. Well, why don't you join in the prayer as well? Let me pray. Father God, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to die in our place that our sins can be forgiven. Thank you that you sent the Spirit to dwell within and to bring each of us into a relationship with you and with each other. Please forgive and cleanse me of my sin and fill me with your Spirit. Give me joy in my relationship with you. And thank you for calling me to play a part in your great plan of salvation. Please show me what it is that you're calling me to, and help me to surrender my whole life to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if that's the first time that you have prayed a prayer like that, then please do get in touch. You'll see the email address at the bottom of the screen. We would love to hear from you and support you as you begin this new exciting adventure with Jesus. And if you've been struggling as a Christian, if you are feeling really dry and God feels distant, then why not get in touch? We would love to support you and to talk you through that as well, and see if there's any way in which we can help you. We've nearly reached the end of our time together this morning. Do remember that after this service, as ever, there are people available to pray for you. So if there is any issue for which you'd like prayer, small or great, then do head over to this Zoom meeting where you'll receive a very warm welcome. Our final song is really a prayer that God would breathe his Spirit into our hearts again, that we might know his life and his presence. Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Bring the presence of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole.
Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
It's been wonderful to spend this time together thinking about all that God has done by sending his Spirit to us. Let me finish with the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Come let